to the First Congregational Church, the United Church of Christ in St. Albans. We're a welcoming community of spiritual seekers, believers, and doubters. Whether you're joining us online, on cable TV, or in the sanctuary, please know that no matter where you are on life's journey, you're welcome here to journey with us. I think, Judy, you have an announcement.
Good morning. We are very happy to continue to have people here in the sanctuary. We want to continue to be able to do that. The deacons felt that it's been a couple of months. We need to give a reminder about the rules that have been put out. Just not that anyone is disobeying them, but just a reminder that this is what we have to do. The doors are open. We have to leave them open. I know it's cold. Dress warm. Wear your sweaters, wear your coats if you have to. We need to get the airflow and keep it going. Masks must be worn at all times. The pulpit is the only place that we have plexiglass, so anyone who comes to the lectern needs to wear a mask as well. I think we're doing fairly well observing the social distancing of 6 feet. Your contact tracing, we need to have phone numbers and addresses for people who are visiting. And at the end of the service, we do ask that everyone exit the sanctuary. I know it's cold outside and nobody wants to hang outside to chit chat, but we need to move outside for any visiting and not hang out in the sanctuary. We need to be able to get it to work. And one last thing, today is Communion Sunday. We have these little cups. Hopefully you picked one up on the way in. If not, we can come back to the effects. We have some for you. There's two holes on here. Some people may have used these last months. I think we have people here who may not have. The first one is a clear hole, and that releases a little wafer. And the second one is the pole that releases the juice. So that's how we will do communion. Thank you.
Also, a reminder this year for honoring and remembering our loved ones, we are going to do it differently. We are no longer decorating the sanctuary with poinsettias. Instead, we'll be making donations in your loved one's name to Ada's Closet, which is an essentials closet at the high school for teens in need. And there are information sheets and envelopes in the narthex. The mitten tree is looking fantastic. We are still taking donations, so if you're a crafter, knitter, or you know someone who you can hit up, do so, and we'll take your nice warm woolies of mittens, socks, scarves, hats. Last year, we donated to more than 6 organizations. And I know it's a little ways off, but we are anticipating having an in-person Christmas Eve service. You will need to register so that we can make sure that we have enough room for everyone and we're properly socially distanced. And if there are no more announcements, would you please join me in the spirit of prayer for the morning prayer? In the wilderness, prepare the way of the Lord. Make straight in desert a highway for our God. Every valley shall be lifted up, and every mountain and hill made low. The uneven ground shall become level, and the rough places a plain. Then the glory of the Lord shall be revealed, and all people shall see it together.
Thank you.
God be with us in this light of peace. And in the spirit of peace, please join me for the prayer of confession. Holy One, we are people who seek a more peaceful world, yet we struggle to tear down the injustices of racism, sexism, poverty, environmental destruction. Gracious Creator, we are people who seek peace in our hearts, yet we struggle to release our negative thoughts, envy, greed. Comfort us, O God, for we struggle and at times we don't even know where to begin. Restore us to your path of hope and peace. Amen. God's love is unwavering. It's eternal. God's blessing has been poured out for all of creation, and nothing can separate you from that blessing. Nothing can separate you from God's love. Be mindful of that today and every day. Praise be to God. This morning's gospel is from the Gospel of Mark, chapter 1, verses 1 through 8. The beginning of the good news of Jesus Christ, the Son of God. As it is written in the prophet Isaiah, "See, I am sending my messenger ahead of you, who will prepare your way, the voice of one crying out in the wilderness, 'Prepare the way of God, make his path straight.' John the Baptizer appeared in the wilderness, proclaiming a baptism of repentance for the forgiveness of sins. And people from the whole Judean countryside and all the people of Jerusalem were going out to him and were baptized by him in the river Jordan, confessing their sins. Now, John was clothed with camel's hair and a leather belt around his waist, and he ate locusts and wild honey. He proclaimed, 'The one who is more powerful than I is coming after me. I am not worthy to stoop down and untie the thong of his sandals. I have baptized you with water, but he will baptize you with the Holy Spirit.'" So ends this morning's reading. Please join me in the spirit of prayer. May the words of my mouth and the meditations of my heart be acceptable to you, O God, my strength and my redeemer. I thought we had a pretty incredible Advent reading this morning. And I just wanted to ask, JJ, we talked a little bit before, you prepared for this, you practiced, right? You could tell. You did a great job.
Thank you.
You're welcome. Did anyone encourage you to practice?
Janie did.
Janie did. I just realized I'm without my mask. So sometimes we need someone to sort of encourage us to prepare, even though we know it's good to prepare. We want to be prepared so that we do a good job and we're not having that anxiety that comes with not being prepared. When I was JJ's age, I was not prepared a lot. So I could have learned a lot from you. So today we are talking about John the Baptist, and what he's doing is asking people to prepare. And I love John the Baptist. He's an itinerant prophet, and he's, you know, wild and revolutionary and completely anti-establishment. And he's more than that. In this morning's, those few lines of this morning's reading from Mark, it's pointing to a significant backstory. And backstories are important. My husband, as some of you may know, is an actor and director. And when we were in Maine, he was part of a New Works Theater. That is, they worked with contemporary playwrights to do original plays. And I was called upon at one point to fill in for an actress who couldn't complete her role. And it was a very small part, like one scene, maybe 5 minutes on stage. So I went to rehearsal and the playwright was there. And he started going on this long backstory for my character, who was on stage for 5 minutes, and just who she was, where she was from, who her parents were, what her job was, what her education was, whether she was married or not. It was incredible. And that information was never shared with the audience, so part of me was like, why am I even doing this? But what I realized as I was learning the part and performing it, that having that knowledge helped me place that character within the play, which added to the audience's understanding of the play as a whole. And it was really interesting to do that work. It was really like walking in someone else's life. It was, well, I guess it was called acting. So the backstory for the opening scene in Mark, which is not explicitly shared with the audience. But the audience, especially of that time, was really well aware of the story. John the Baptist points us to the prophets and prophecies of the Hebrew Scriptures, in particular, the prophet Elijah, and the prophecies found in Malachi. The Gospel of John even opens up with a quote from Isaiah. John wears rough clothes. It's a camel hair shirt with a leather belt. He eats locusts and honey, which is another way of saying he doesn't eat meat or drink wine. And describing John this way is no accident. Mark is linking him to the Hebrew prophet Elijah. He is seen as Elijah. This is important because Elijah will return when the Messiah comes. Associating John the Baptist with Elijah alerts the reader to the coming of the Messiah. Mark is connecting the good news of Jesus with the prophecies of salvation found in the Hebrew Scriptures, including the opening words, "I am sending a messenger ahead of you. Prepare the way of the Lord, make his paths straight." In Malachi chapter 3 is written, "See, I am sending my messenger to prepare the way for you." Chapter 4 goes on, "Lo, I will send you the prophet Elijah before the great and terrible day of the Lord comes. He will turn the hearts of parents to their children and the hearts of children to their parents." The story of Elijah, for me, the story of Elijah that really comes to mind has to do with Elijah turning people's hearts back to God. Elijah was what I call a VIP, which is a very important prophet. Prophets are chosen by God to speak for God and to lead God's people. Typically, prophets are sent to draw people closer to God. They frequently point out where the people or we have gone wrong, which in turn tends to make them not terribly popular with certain people. The story of Elijah is found in the Hebrew Scriptures, 1 and 2 Kings. And during this time, it was the reign of King Ahab and his wife Jezebel. Ahab and Jezebel's marriage had formed an alliance between Israel and the Tyrian Empire. So Jezebel came from a completely different culture and had different gods that she worshipped. Jezebel instituted the worship of Baal. Ahab built a temple of Baal in Samaria, which served the Tyrian courtiers and merchants, as well as Jezebel. And this temple became very influential with the aristocracy of Israel. According to the Jewish Virtual Library, Jezebel is a prototype of the enemies of the God of Israel and his prophets. She is depicted as a zealot for the deities of her homeland, who slaughtered the prophets of Yahweh and supported the prophets of Baal and Asherah. So we have this time of growing allegiance to Baal, and Elijah is sent by God to turn people back to God. "How long," said Elijah, "will you go limping with two different opinions?" So Elijah decides to confront the priests of Baal. There's a competition. They go up onto Mount Carmel. There are 450 priests for Baal and Elijah on the other side. Each set will sacrifice a bull and ask God to consume the bull. So the 450 priests slaughter their bull, and they start singing out to God, praying and dancing, and they do this for hours, and nothing happens. The sacrifice just sits there. So when they finish, now it's Elijah's turn. He sacrifices the bull and prepares the sacrifice. Not only does he set up the wood and put the cut up meat on it, he soaks it all with water. And he says, "O Lord, answer me, so that this people may know that you, O Lord, are God, and that you have, and so that they will turn their hearts back to you." And God hears him and sends fire down and consumes the offering, water and all. And at that moment, this sort of cataclysmic moment, the Israelites fall down and they say, "The Lord is God indeed." The Jewish Virtual Library notes that this commitment to monotheism is repeated 7 times after the Yom Kippur service each year. So you can see just how important Elijah is. In essence, Elijah saved the Hebrew faith in God and the first commandment that there is no God but God. So years passed, and Elijah continued his prophetic work for God. And when his time on earth came to an end, he was taken up in a whirlwind in a chariot of fire to heaven. At the Seder, wine is poured out for him, and they leave a door open so that Elijah can come in. At the end of Shabbat, a song is sung about Elijah, hoping he will come speedily in our days, along with the Messiah, Son of David, to redeem us. So when we read this opening passage of Mark, it's really important to have these things in mind so we can see how it would affect people, certainly of the era. So this is just a long way of my saying that this story draws upon history and tradition, and it highlights to us, the reader, that something really important is happening. Here, John the Baptist is understood to be Elijah, and Elijah will come with the Messiah. So if you see a new Elijah, you're alerted that the Messiah is near. And Mark really sets us in the middle of the action. Mark is one of the gospel that doesn't have the birth story. Birth story is in Matthew and in Luke. So Mark sets us down with this itinerant prophet baptizing people in the Jordan, preparing the way for Jesus, out in the desert, preaching, baptizing. And people came from all over to see John. He was charismatic and popular. And he's not afraid to tell people that he is not the one, right? He's pointing to the one, and he's not even worthy to untie that person's shoes. So he says, prepare yourself. Prepare the way of the Lord and make his path straight. So how do we prepare ourselves? I would really like to make a straight path to God, but how do I do that? Do I do it through my actions? Do I act justly? Do I share my love with my neighbor? And that's frequently what we talk about and what we've been talking about recently. Living in right relation to God includes sharing God's love with others. And we do that through our actions of care and social justice. But here, we're talking about a different kind of preparation. This preparation is spiritual in nature. John baptized people for the repentance of sins. Sin, in modern terms, I think, is a really difficult word. It has shades of meaning that are damaging and shaming and misused. So when we talk about it, I want to talk about it in a very specific way. Sin symbolizes our separation from God. It symbolizes, it means that we are out of right relation with God. And so John uses this cleansing ritual to help heal that separation from God, to bring people closer to God. It's an outward ritual that symbolizes and helps create an internal change. And that's the path that can bring us closer to God. Every week we pray together, the prayer of confession. And that's where we acknowledge our brokenness, our separation from God. And through that acknowledgement, we're brought closer to God. We're straightening the path, and the path is in our heart. Because God is always there with us, but we just have to be open to it. If we close ourselves down, that's when the path goes awry, right? You need that open channel. And that sounds pretty easy, which I find myself saying a lot when I think about spiritual journeys or living the right way. It seems so simple and it's so difficult. Because there are all sorts of things we have to do. For instance, this morning I had to get dressed, have something to eat, feed the cat, go to work, you know, we'll go grocery shopping, we'll drive, someone will cut us off, we'll yell at them, we'll fix dinner, we'll clean the house, I'll worry about my parents. It's a very extensive to-do list. And somehow, opening my heart to God kind of just gets pushed down the list, down and down and down. So how can we open our hearts and keep them open? Well, I think we pray, that comes to mind, an intentional opening to God, whether we're seeking consolation, guidance, or help, or we could be singing out in praise. All of that opens us up. A lot of people practice mindfulness, which is to say the development of awareness, the sort of awareness to the mystery of God, and folks will have small little rituals that they do throughout the day that remind them of that. So no matter how we do it, we need to do it, and it needs to be intentional, just like practicing the Advent reading. It has to be something that we do. In this season, as we prepare our hearts for Christ, we need to have room in our hearts for Jesus. And that's why John is saying, prepare the way, make the path straight. So we need to let go of all the stuff that bogs us down and keeps us from God. There's a very famous, and I'm not going to do it justice, but there is an illustration that they give to ministers when people may be holding on to something unhealthy or grief too long, and they say, you know, you're holding your hands and fists, and you can't pick up a pen, and you can't catch a ball, you can't do anything because you're completely closed down. So that's what our goal is, to sort of let go of the stuff that weighs us down so we can open our hearts, give Christ a place in our. And once we let go of that stuff and we let God in, then we'll know the meaning of peace. Amen. Well, now, I think I need to leave a bunch of masks around. We'll now prepare for communion. And I just want to mention our special communion offering. It's for a Franklin Grand Isle bookmobile, which I learned through watching a video that some people call Figgy. Our very own Hadley volunteers for the bookmobile, and it's a cause that's very close to her heart. I've spent some time on their website, and it's a great service. It's a beautiful thing that they're doing. Literacy is so important. Developing a love of books is so important. When I was working on the street, I saw how hard it was for people who struggled with literacy, who struggled to read and write. It makes life very difficult. So it's amazing that these folks are going out and encouraging kids to read. The bookmobile's mission is to promote a lifelong love of learning and create community connection through providing greater access to books, information, and activities. Visit their website, which is fgibookmobile.org, to make a donation, or if you would like, leave a check in the offering plate made out to First Congregational and put bookmobile in the memo, and we'll see that it gets to them. Please join me in the celebration of communion. Ours is an open table, and everyone is welcome. God be with you. Lift up your hearts. Give thanks to God. We remember that on the night of betrayal and desertion, and on the eve of his death, Jesus gathered his disciples to the Passover feast. Jesus took the bread, and after giving thanks, he broke it and gave it to the disciples and said, "Take this and eat. This is my body broken for you. Do this in remembrance of me." In the same way, he took the cup after supper, saying, "Drink this, all of you. This is the blood of the new covenant, which is poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins. Do this as often as you drink in remembrance of me." May the presence of Christ, body and spirit, keep and preserve you to everlasting life. Let us pray. Thank you, most holy God, for meeting us in this simple meal. May your presence within us ripple beyond us, ever expanding, until the day when you gather all your saints from the four winds to share in your eternal banquet. Do we have any joys and concerns this morning? Please join me in the spirit of prayer. Holy One, as we walk through Advent, help us to live in hope and peace. Despite the many challenges of our world, the continuing pandemic, the aftermath of the hurricanes in Central America, systemic racism, climate change, we pray especially for those who are living in isolation and for those struggling with loss. This morning we ask for special prayers for the victims of a horrific car crash in Trier. This is a place that's very special to Stefan. He lived there for a number of years, very close connections. A car driven by someone who's very disturbed mowed down folks in a pedestrian way, killing 5 and injuring 15. It was very traumatic to that community. And our prayers are with you, Stefan, and the community. Holy One, we pray for your guidance in all things. Grant us peace and understanding. In your holy name we pray. Amen. Now, if you'll join me for the prayer that Jesus taught his disciples. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Go in peace. Share the love of God. Open your hearts. Be kind to each other. Amen. A note on the postlude, Stefan will be dedicating this to the victims of the accident.